مہدی معود کا فرزند گرامی، تو شوکت اسلام کا سرمست پیامی، تو شوکت اسلام کا سرمست پیامی، اسلام کی دنیا میں اشاعت تیرا مقصود، اے مصلح معود، اے مصلح معود، اے مصلح معود، اے مصلح معود.
The truth of prophets is demonstrated by the fulfillment of the prophecies that they make. The founder of the Ahmadiyya community in Islam, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad of Qadian, alayhi salam, the promised Messiah, was the recipient of many prophecies. One of the most inspiring revelations concerned the advent of Muslim Ma'ud, or the promised reformer. On the 20th of February, 1886, the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, announced that God had revealed to him that he would be blessed with a son. The revelation stated, "A handsome and pure boy will be bestowed on thee. He will be extremely intelligent and understanding, and will be meek of heart and filled with secular and spiritual knowledge. His fame will spread to the ends of the earth, and people will be blessed through him." This particular prophecy of the promised Messiahs is referred to as the prophecy of Al-Muslim Ma'ud, or the promised reformer. In accordance with these words, the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, was blessed with a son born on January the 12th, 1889, in Qadian, in India. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, radiyallahu anhu, was later to become Khalifatul Masih II. His life was filled with many extraordinary accomplishments, and he was to become a prolific writer, scholar, and leader. At a young age, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad developed an interest in the study of the Holy Quran and the traditions of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. He was tutored in this by the first Khalifa, Hakim Molvi Nuruddin, radiyallahu anhu. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin's contribution to Jamaat activities began early, and at age 17 he organized a literary committee called Tafshizul Azan. A quarterly magazine devoted to writing about spiritual values was set up, and this publication is still enjoyed by children today as it continues to be published under the same name. When he was only 19, the father whom he revered deeply passed away. Standing at the side of the promised Messiah's deceased body, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin pledged, "If all others should leave the Jamaat of the promised Messiah and I should be left alone, I will stand by the covenant of allegiance, the purpose for which Hazrat Ahmad was sent to this world. I shall leave no stone unturned to fulfill that purpose." The second Khalifa lived another 57 years after making that pledge, and every day of his life bore testimony to the fact that he lived up to his high resolve. In 1914, he was elected as the second Khalifa. He was only 25 at the time. The community was not very large in number. However, much more serious was the fact that some members of the community had challenged his position of office and had broken away. They protested that such a young man was unsuitable to become caliph of the whole community. How wrong they were! The golden milestones and landmarks of Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin's Khilafat stand witness to his suitability as Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II, the promised son. A month into his Khilafat in April 1914, he formed a consultative body known as Majlis Shura. This went on to become established as a permanent institution within the community in 1922, and it is convened annually or as it is needed to make important policy decisions of the community. This blessed idea is now one of the great and unique features of the Ahmadiyya Jamaat. Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II was very aware of the religious and educational needs of Ahmadi ladies. To this end, he established the organization Lajna-e-Maila in 1922. A magazine, Al-Misbah, was introduced in 1926 solely for this organization. To ensure that the educational needs of girls was being looked after, the Nusrat Girls High School was established in 1928, and in 1951, Jamia Nusrat, or the Women's College, started functioning in Rabwah in Pakistan. Ahmadi girls were thus enabled to get education close to their homes. Religious education, as well as secular, was also given in these schools. In December 1938, Kudamul Ahmadiyya, an organization consisting of young men between the ages of 15 to 40, was set up. Atfalul Ahmadiyya was also set up to cater for the needs of boys under 16 years. In 1940, Majlis Ansarullah was established for all male members of the Jamaat over the age of 40. These auxiliary organizations of the Jamaat have remained in place from the time they were set up until today, and within them all members of the Jamaat work together and show an exceptional spirit of brotherhood and sisterhood as they strive to inculcate spiritual and righteous values within themselves. The Madrasa Ahmadiyya, which was set up for religious instruction, was raised to the status of Jamia Ahmadiyya by Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin in May 1928. This institution was to train learned members of the community as missionaries to take the message of Islam to various parts of the world. One of the main aims of the Ahmadiyya community is the propagation of the message of Islam. During his Khilafat, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih II took major steps in ensuring the fulfillment of this objective. After his election as Khalifa, he started afresh the translation of the Holy Quran into English with explanatory notes in order to deliver the message of Islam to the European nations. Muslim missionaries were trained and then posted out to various countries. Later on, this responsibility was handed over to Anjuman Tariq-e-Jadid, or the Department for Foreign Missions. The first Ahmadiyya mission was established under Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin's Khilafat and was in Mauritius. Hazrat Sufi Ghulam Muhammad was the first missionary there, and he arrived on June 15, 1915. Hazrat Mufti Muhammad Sadiq, a companion of the Promised Messiah, arrived in Philadelphia in the USA on February 15, 1920, to preach Islam to the US. The Tehrik-e-Jadid scheme is still alive today. Mosques, mission houses, clinics, hospitals, schools, colleges, and printing presses have been built in nearly 176 countries of the world dedicated to the service of Islam. To attend to the religious needs of those in the Indo-Pakistan subcontinent, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin set up the Waqf-e-Jadid scheme in 1958. This had the aim of intensifying Islamic activities in the rural areas of the Indo-Pakistan subcontinent. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin inspired the community to cultivate the spirit of sacrifice within themselves. He urged the unemployed to work, even if it was for a small wage. He advised the community to develop values of simplicity, modesty, and austerity in their manner of food, dress, and housing. He laid down guidelines such as cooking only one dish for meals. Simple though it was, it created a collective spirit of sacrifice not seen in any other community. In 1924, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin was invited to attend the Wembley Conference of Religions and to represent Islam. His arrival in London was covered widely in the press. Chowdhury Muhammad Zafrullah Khan
radiyallahu anhu
read out the English translation of his address. The audience listened attentively, and the address received a great deal of attention. While in London, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin also laid the foundation stone of the Fazl Mosque. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin was a great intellect. No subject was too difficult for him to speak upon, whether it was about the existence of God, prayer, divine decrees, worship, the benefit of divine law, life after death, or heaven and hell and their reality. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin was able to explain and discuss all of these topics clearly and understandably. His greatest achievement, perhaps, was his outstanding contribution to literature. He wrote over 200 books and pamphlets. Though he had no worldly qualifications, he clearly displayed the ability, as was promised by Allah, in both religious and secular knowledge. As early as 1913, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin launched Al-Fazl, the weekly Urdu newspaper of the Jamaat, and that continues to publish to this day. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin wrote Tafsir-e-Saghir, a brief commentary in the Holy Quran, and Tafsir-e-Kabir, an exhaustive commentary on the Holy Quran, which has been described as a fathomless ocean of knowledge. This 10,000-page commentary contains a deep exposition of thousands of spiritual truths and hidden secrets of the Holy Quran, many of which had not been presented before. On the 20th of September 1948, the Jamaat faced a major upheaval following the partition of India and Pakistan. The centre of the Jamaat was moved from Qadian in India to Rabwah, a small town near Chinoort in Pakistan, which was then a barren tract of land. 313 volunteers elected to remain in Qadian to protect its holy precincts. The group included Mirza Wasim Ahmed, Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin's son. It was a very testing time for the Jamaat in India, who was surrounded by hostile forces. But in spite of this, the Jamaat established itself and flourished in Rabwah. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin launched the Waqf-e-Zindagi scheme for dedicating one's entire life for the service of Islam. He initiated the annual Sirat-ul-Nabi, which are public meetings convened to present to the world the life and character of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. He also instituted the annual observance of Religious Founders Day, which is to celebrate the lives of founders of all the great religions. These events have been instrumental in promoting interfaith understanding and appreciation. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin had been given a prophetic title, Fazl-e Ummah, indicating his spiritual affinity to Hazrat Umar,
radiyallahu anhu,
the second successor to the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. His achievements bore a close resemblance to those of Hazrat Umar,
radiyallahu anhu,
in that he was a brilliant administrator and laid down the foundations for the structure of the Jamaat as we know it today. The 52 glorious years of his Khilafat saw many great achievements. It genuinely represented a golden era in the history of Ahmadiyyat and Islam. He led the community to time through great adversity. With all the odds against him, even to have survived would have been a great achievement. But the promised reformer did so much more and fulfilled the prophecy to the word. To the members of the community, he was at all times a deeply loving father to whom they could look up to for guidance and advice and encouragement. To all intelligent and reasonable people of goodwill, he proved himself to be a wise friend and counsellor. Towards his opponents, he was forbearing and truly sympathetic over their lack of understanding. And to the afflicted, he was, without discrimination, a ready source of comfort and relief. His demise on the 9th of November 1965 plunged the members of the community into overwhelming and intense grief. The editor of The Light, a weekly publication by the Lahori group, wrote under a caption entitled A Great Nation Builder that the death of Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin Mahmud Ahmad, head of the Ahmadiyya movement, rang the curtain down on an eventful career packed with a multitude of far-reaching enterprises. A man of versatile genius and dynamic personality, there was hardly a sphere of contemporary thought and life during the past century, from religious scholarship to missionary organization, even political leadership, on which the deceased did not leave a deep imprint. Hazrat Mirza Bashiruddin, in his own words, on the occasion of the annual convention in 1961, said, I declare, depending on the favors and blessings of Allah, that my name shall be preserved in the world forever. Although I will die one day, my name shall never be erased from history. This is a decree of Allah. On the occasion of the centenary celebrations of the Jamaat Ahmadiyya, one of the sons of the second Khalifa, who was then the fourth Khalifa of the promised Messiah, alayhis salam, Hazrat Mirza Tahir Ahmad, rahimullah ta'ala, said, So let us enter the new century with the determination that we would respond to the call of Muslim Aoud,
رضي الله عنه,
every moment of whose life saw the fulfillment of that prophecy. If you respond to that call, you will live the age of Hazrat Muslim Aoud. If you live the age of Hazrat Muslim Aoud,
رضي الله عنه,
you will live the age of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, the greatest lover of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings be upon him. And if you live the age of the promised Messiah, alayhi salam, you are assured by the Holy Quran that you will live the age of the Holy Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. A time will come when all people will proclaim in unison, may the mercy of Allah descend upon this great servant of Islam, who sacrificed his whole life for this cause.
Tu Mehdi-e Maud ka farzand-e-garami, Tu Shaukat-e-Islam ka sarmast-payami, Tu Shaukat-e-Islam ka sarmast-payami, Islam ki dunia mein ishaat tera maqsood, Ae Musleh Maud, Ae Musleh Maud, Ae Musleh Maud, Ae Musleh Maud.